This is the Fisher 800C. It was called the Executive. This radio was, this stereo receiver was basically marketed in the 60s. It is an all tube receiver, stereo, or no transistors in it. And the radio was marketed to people that had a lot of money, because this was a very expensive unit. This was the top of the line Fisher stereo receiver. I think it's actually the best one Fisher ever made, and it very well might be the best tube receiver ever made, because this this receiver is built like a tank. It is a very good design, and I'll show you that later when we show you the insides. Now, as you can see, this one has the case. Case is in very good shape. This unit was sold with the case as an option, because most of them were actually built into stereo furniture. So in that case, you don't need a case, but you could also use it as a desktop standalone unit, which is the way you see it now. Which is, I think, the nicest, but you know, whatever rocks your boat, I guess, floats your boat. Now, the PA has two tubes in balance, push-pull tube amplifier that uses the 7591A tube, two of them, of course, and then a second set for the stereo, so four in total. I'll show you that in a minute when we go have a look at the insides. Let's look at the controls. Pretty straightforward. There is two speaker sets that you can hook up. This switch basically determines speaker 1, speaker 2, or both, or earphones. There is a stereo a jack here for your earphones, headphones. Radio obviously has a bass control. It has a treble, high, adjust. There is obviously a balance, left and a right. There is a filter to limit the highs and a filter to limit the lows. This is for AM, I'll show you that later. Amplitude modulation, broadcast band. You can go to wide and broad, actually narrow and broad. They call it sharp, but they mean sharp in terms of the audio that you will get. But in reality, they narrow up the RF bandwidth. And if you go too broad, the RF bandwidth is widened, and therefore you get more high in your signal on AM. Tape monitor, that was basically used to monitor recording, as it was being recorded. Don't use that nowadays anymore, because nobody has a tape deck anymore, but that's what that was for. This is basically in the input selector, tape, phono, there was a record player, stereo, phono, stereo, FM automatic, that's what we have now. Then the stereo decoder basically determines whether it should kick in or not. You can also leave the stereo decoder on all the time. You can go to FM mono. This is the AM broadcast band, and this is the auxiliary input you could use for your CD player, but here they still say tape. There is a loudness that was pretty famous in the 60s and 70s. That was basically a trick to make your audio sound louder without having to crank it up, because the human ear is more sensitive for high and low when the volume is up. So by favoring the highs and the lows, it makes it sound like the music is louder without actually being so. Volume, obviously, and this is the stereo tuning, the FM tuning. You need a pretty strong signal to get the FM decoder to kick in. I have it hooked up to a simple wired dipole that I made myself. You don't need a extensive FM antenna for this unit to work nice. And that's the Fisher 800C executive tube receiver. Let's have a look on the inside, and I can show you that this is not your mom and pop receiver with five tubes. This thing has almost 20 tubes in it, if I'm not mistaken. And let's go have a look at that. Before we take off the case, I wanted to show you the rear apron, the back. These are the hookups for the antenna. You can put up an external AM antenna, AM broadcast, just a wire will do, or an FM antenna. You can hook up the FM antenna for normal sensitivity or local. If you have very strong stations in your neighborhood, you can hook it up to a less sensitive input. This is the ferrite antenna for AM broadcast. As you can see, it can be folded out and swiveled in. That's basically to prevent damage during transport. Now this particular one I have connectorized. That's the only modification that was done to this radio. There is an SMA connector that hooks up the ferrite antenna, and that does not do any modifications to the circuit. It's just to make it possible to take this off for transport, because as you might know, for those of you that know this receiver, the AM antennas are always either missing or completely destroyed, because even with the swiveling concept, they damage during transport, and that's the end of your AM reception. So I did it like this, that I can take the whole thing off when it's stored or transported. You can hook up two extra 115 volt AC outputs so that the radio will also switch secondary equipment. These are the inputs, auxiliary tape monitor, recorder out, so you could do monitoring. Phono, high impedance, low impedance record players, and a tape head. That's basically the input for the tape recorder. For a CD player, you would use the auxiliary. This is kind of unique. You basically hook up the speakers here, but this is a internal strip that allows you to choose different impedances without having to change that on the speaker. So that is kind of a novel concept that they have used, to change the impedance of the audio output with these tap points. It goes from 4, 8 to 16 ohms, so you can hook up any speaker that is available today. You can also hook up a center speaker. That would be nice if you have a subwoofer or something, but it's not really necessary. The normal speakers are hooked up here. Like I said, there's two sets of speakers possible, a left and right for the first set, left and right for the second set. These are the tubes. The radio has all the tubes original except for two of these. Two seem to have been replaced. This one is still original with the, it says the Fisher. So do all the signal tubes that I'll show you later. This one is replaced, I think, and that one was replaced. But I was gonna put new tubes in it, but the thing works so well. I think it's a waste of money. You don't have to do that. These tubes are perfectly okay. They have full output and sound terrific. Here actually you can see the output power, 30 watts RMS for left and right, of course. 37.5 peak is what the amplifier is specified for. It's very well made. It looks very professional. Everything's built on a chassis, as you will see later. There is no PCBs used in it. Early PCB radios still using tubes always were bad, because the PCB material kind of burns slowly, blackens, and that is a bad thing. But with a chassis concept, you don't have to worry about that. But like I said, we'll take off the cover and I'll show you the rest of the chassis. Alright, we took off the case, so I can show you the radio without the Okay, it's on the insides. This is basically what you have on the inside. This is the power transformer. These are the stereo, the output, audio output transformers, left and right. Here you see the tubes. It is the 7591A tube. There you see the AM ferrite antenna. It can be swiveled, so when you transport it, you can move it in when it's at the final location. You basically can move it out. This is the RF section. This is the AM preamplifier. This is the mixer. This is the FM preamplifier. This is the mixer. Double triode. This is pentode, I think. I'm not quite sure. This is the RF section, AM and FM. And this here is the audio section. This is the stereo decoder, also called stereo multiplexer. It has three triodes, so six active elements in total. It's quite a lot. Most of them only at four. As you can see, it's in a very good shape. No corrosion whatsoever. This sure was a rare find. The amplifier is capable of producing about 30-35 watts average. I think it's like 45 peak. Works pretty good. This is the tuning wheel. As you see, there's a flywheel action. Here you can see how the string basically brings the coupling between the tuning and the actual variable capacitor inside here. It's kind of a nice touch. They actually put the strain on this end wheel, so there is no pull on the capacitor. It shows you the quality of this unit throughout. No expense was spared to develop this radio by Fisher. Let's see what we have in terms of the... We now have it switched to FM, as you can hear. Speaker set 1. I do have it on a quickly assembled dipole. So you do need a dipole, small dipole, to pull in the FM stations. Works quite well. She can see the stereo beacon comes on when there is a stereo signal. Really works nice. Considering this radio is 40-45 years old. An excellent design. That's the bass. High, balance,
and that's the speaker. His latest book is called Wealthy, Healthy, and Wise. And here now is David Mines on today's Focus on the Family.
Places like Omaha, not that Omaha isn't prosperous, but it's a place that's not gaining population were it not for the...
The show they used to have on Saturday nights on the Joy FM, but it's happening 24-7.
How many of you here today would have...
they say the average man thinks about sex.
Really works well. Let's try the AM band. We're now on the AM broadcast band. Of course, you won't get any stereo signal there.
Your entertainment calendar each week right here on AM 930, The Answer.
Cuba.
Calamari, that's not that nasty stuff that gets clogged in the drain line. It causes
Like I said, the radio has a RF amplifier for the AM section. That is unusual. Most two broadcast receivers did not have that. That also gives additional selectivity on the RF input, which means the image frequency is much better rejected. Because it has two tuned circuits on the input, where most tube radios only have one. That's basically it. The Fisher 800C, probably the best tube receiver, broadcast receiver ever made. It certainly was the most expensive. It was only for very wealthy people in the 60s. And it's still a remarkable radio, even today. This one is near mint, excellent shape. Almost all tubes in it are original. Probably can see it. It still says Fisher. All the signal tubes are original. I think two of the PA's ones have been replaced. So that's the only difference I could find. I was going to replace the PA tubes, but it still works fine, so I thought, why mess with it? It works perfect. Okay, that was basically it. I hope you enjoyed the video. I just wanted to show you that top-notch stereo equipment already existed in the 60s, and arguably actually better than it is today. But that's also a matter of taste, of course. The Fisher 800C Executive, the best tube stereo receiver ever made. Expensive as could be in the days. And it still measures up very well against what's available on the market today. If you're on a real eye catcher, something that stands out against all the garbage you buy today, this one is for you. Thanks for watching this video.